today we've really been all across the design spectrum. We started the day with Peter Rice from the entertainment industry, IBM, TBWA, and Adobe, covering design and business, advertising, and media. And so now we've gathered you all to really talk about design in tech. So the first question is, how is design in tech different than design in these other fields? And open.
All right, I'll start. So I've had this conversation a few times today, actually. So I had a previous career. I worked in marketing and advertising, and then prior to that, I actually worked in graphic design, and now I work in tech, so I've kind of spanned across all these different industries. I'd say that the real difference is, and something that I tell people who want to get into product design, is that you have to have the mindset that there is no actual like end solution to design. You're never going to have the perfect solution, unlike maybe an advertising campaign where you know, it launches, it runs for 3 months, and then it's over, and you move on to the next thing. In product design, you just are constantly like working. Your audience is changing, your product is changing. You know, something that works today breaks tomorrow as you scale bigger. So that's probably like the biggest difference as a designer. The other thing is that the way you work with teams is very different. It's, you know, in other worlds, maybe it's more of like a waterfall method of, you know, I'm the creative, I go off and come up with crazy ideas and come back and be like, here's what we're gonna make, and then everyone else is forced to kind of create that. Whereas in, you know, product design, it's really like a team effort. You know, you have data science, you have your user research, you have your content strategists, your PM, your engineers, all these people are all working together within a product team to solve these problems, and so you're just one facet of that, and you bring your tool, which is like your ability to design, to that team.
Yeah, a lot of that resonates with me. My background also had about like 6 years in agency work, and there's sort of this like, you throw it over the fence and it's done, or it's like super transient. I feel like probably the starkest thing about product design that I've noticed, both as someone who's done the design side of it and then done the management side of it, is sort of a degree of accountability, in that as an agency designer, or at least I feel like maybe the times are changing, but like, I would, you know, you get assigned to something, it's like, go off and make it pretty, or go off and like make it cool, and you would kind of go off and make it cool, and they'd be like, well, it looks cool, and maybe I don't like the blue, but you know, that's largely kind of successful, and then, you know, get implemented, thrown out in the world, and maybe it would exist in a couple years, and maybe it wouldn't. Whereas in product, you're held a lot more accountable to the decisions that you make, both at like a business level and a design level, so it requires you to deeply consider how you're working with cross-functional teams, like a lot of the stuff that you just mentioned. I sort of underpin that idea that like, you now are required to explain your work and understand the feedback and really dig into it, and that's way more prominent in product than at least my experience of things like agency.
To add two quick points. Everything you're saying, I came from an advertising agency previously as well, and it was this over the fence. So two things I think have been really amazing that's different is the ability to learn a little bit more. It's something I missed in agencies. So I didn't really, you were told who the user was, as opposed to really getting to see it firsthand. And learning, and like you said, how it changes over time as you scale. And the second thing is like that ownership. You really have a lot more ownership of what you're doing. And so you are very incentivized to do the right thing. So to me, those are the two most striking differences.
I never was in the advertising business. I've always been a product designer. Actually, before product designer, I was actually in the games industry before I came to Xbox. And what was interesting about that is we always started with the story. And when I got into product design initially, we always started with the technology. And I was like, why are we doing this? You know. So I think in general, like as designers, we're problem solvers. Independent of where you are, where you start. Sure, there's always dynamics, personalities, different ways of working. But if we always go back to what are we trying to do, who our user is, ask that why question, it shouldn't matter if you're on the product design side or the advertising side. And I've kind of seen it as I think anybody who's been in the industry for a while, as you notice that we've really moved into really focusing on the user. And it's something that, you know, as game developers, you do all the time, because if it's not fun, and your kid's not going to do well, and it's usually about, let's think about the user and what they want to engage with at the time.
Yeah,
So it sounds like design decisions are very consequential, especially in tech, and maybe a little less forgiving. So at what stage in this process does design really emerge and become more influential in the process of building a product in a tech company?
This is a trick question. It should start right at the beginning. Design absolutely should start right at the beginning. But the reality is it doesn't from team to team based on, again, honestly, everything you do in product design comes down to personalities and relationships. That's all it comes down to. If you have a great relationship with your peers, you could jump in right at the beginning with them as you start thinking about this. The way I've dealt with this is absolutely spend a lot of time building that relationship with people, get in the trenches with all the other disciplines, do this over and over and over again, build that credibility, and then they come to you. They're like, hey, we can't start this project without design. We need you there right away. And then the next level up from that is you kind of show what I call your design superpowers. What are our superpowers over the other disciplines? And it really is about, and I use that to our advantage, and one of them is inspiration, is how do we inspire the rest of the product team to really understand what we're doing. And out of this inspiration could be a vision video, whatever comes, this shared vision of what we're trying to do. And if that shared vision happens really early in the process, where everybody knows what we're trying to do. Now the shared vision will change along the way, but having a focus on that and early on in the process will really help. And you can tell in the products, the good products and bad ones. All the great ones that I feel that I worked on have been every single lead in all the disciplines knew exactly what they were building. So
maybe to narrow the question a little bit, has there been a time for the others sitting up here where in the company maybe a decision has been made where design is not at the focus of it and where that maybe led to some difficulties and how you've had to kind of bring the team back together to align ideas?
Yeah, I can speak to that, not super specifically, but I was previously on the commerce team at Pinterest. And when I came into the team, there was no design lead. And so the PM and EM on the team were really collaborating together, coming up not at the project level, but the team level, what the strategy of the team was. And so when I came into the team, it, like you said, it was run based off of technology first. And it wasn't really doing so hot. The numbers weren't so great, and they had decided on the strategy and were forging ahead with it because they knew if they upped a certain volume, well, yeah, you can hit that numbers, but like if you talk to any user, they're gonna be like, this is crap. When I came onto the team, we really, obviously had the interest of my peers, and then over time, started to really talk to users and bring in more user empathy, and we redid the strategy. And like you said, that design has a superpower of inspiring people and storytelling, and so through that, I was able to convince my peers that we needed to consider the user more, and we were also able to kind of reroute the trajectory of the team because of that, because we were able to storytell to, you know, Ben and Evan, the co-founders, and tell them why we needed to change strategy. And so it made it a lot smoother of a transition.
Just to add a quick thought, I think, you know, one of designers' jobs, we never see this on like a job request or a resume, is the ability to build trust. I think that, you know, a lot of teams, you know, let's say they haven't had much experience with design, or the engineering led, or whatever it may be. The role of design has come in to try to create that trust so that we can create like the right process to allow that story that Cyrus mentioned to be able to be told. And that may require that, you know, you have to take some time on your own and try to script that story, and you can get the other people buy into it, whatever it takes. But I found that like the ability to negotiate and build like rapport and trust is always key to having like successful design in a company.
I'm trying to think of a bad example, but I feel like it's hard, which is maybe good. It's like indication that we take design really seriously at Asana. I think in hearing about this, I actually think a lot more about not just in general designers being leading things, but I think it's kind of to your point that everyone sort of brings an aspect of their job to the table. I spent a lot of time thinking about sort of like engineering and design, and you know, when you focus too much on eng, you end up being like, you're scoping based on technical constraints. But at the same time, like scoping based purely off designers' instincts isn't quite right either. So with a lot of our stuff, like having a research team, having a data science team, you know, involving engineers, PMs, and designers all, and agreeing as a group on what you're trying to do and what you're trying to accomplish, I think it's not that anyone has like an earlier place than any other, and that through that building of consensus, we all feel like we're trying to get to the same goal. So as a designer, I can make a case that, you know, this certain design is worth this trade-off because it better matches, you know, what we all agreed is our success metrics and our use cases, and in that I think we find a lot of success. And when that breaks down is usually when we see the most sort of trouble and feeling like, you know, not empowered or not trusted.
So you've all mentioned user experience or user empathy. So I'm curious how you each have developed or your company's approach to developing user empathy, especially working in big companies, maybe the advantage and disadvantage of kind of staying connected to the user and kind of the philosophy behind.
Yeah, I'm at a big company, but every company breaks down into these smaller pockets, call it even subcultures. And so we try and, one, have our own identity, but then as we think about the product areas we're in, we definitely need to understand the user. I mean, there's too much IQ in the system, and we need more EQ, as they say, in the system. We really need to understand who our users are. The term, you know, walk a mile in somebody else's shoes is absolutely how we need to think about it. Go on research runs with the researchers. When I was working on the Xbox console, we decided we were going to move Xbox to the PC and have a PC client. And I went over to this guy's house, him and his wife, both avid gamers. They had their own gaming rooms, one on each side. And they were yelling across to each other from room to room because there wasn't a good way of communication. And you don't realize this until you actually go there at all the pain points. And it was just, you'll have hilarious stories when you go on this. Another one, it's really insightful. And you need to bring that back in your product. And you don't do that once, you do that many times. I mean, we're moving into this world of iterative design, and we have to be used to it and comfortable with it, but that's also iterative when it comes to revisiting the user, seeing how they do. We do this thing with journals or diaries where we give a user a diary, and every day they write about their experience with the product, and we learn so much from that. And I think that's really one of the important ways of knowing more about a user.
So something interesting about working at Airbnb is that we have a product that is so much about the human interaction. You know, I was describing this earlier, like, you know, we have someone from one country who speaks one language knocking on the door of someone else who speaks a different language, or trying to find a key, or try to communicate over, you know, like a message thread. And it's difficult. It's really, really hard. And like, we're in a beautiful office in San Francisco, and we have free meals and all, like, dogs everywhere, and I cannot possibly relate to this scenario. I'll give you an example. It's like, we're in Cuba, and in Cuba, like, it's basically a cash-based economy because they're afraid of, like, the government. They don't use credit cards, and they're afraid of the government, like, taking money from them, so it's a cash-based economy. So imagine someone coming to that country, which, number one, U.S. dollars do not work. You have to, like, bring in euros or something else, coming to that country, exchanging money, getting ripped off by the government, and then trying to deal with the host who doesn't speak your language and doesn't use the same currency that a tourist uses in the country, and then doing this in the cash. I mean, it's a mess. So the only way to really do that is, like, you have to go there. You have to go talk to these people, figure out what's going on. Like, we deliver money to people by bicycle in Cuba, and that's the only way it works right now. And the way we figured it out was, like, going there and trying to understand, like, how can we actually solve this problem? And it's really, really hard. But you know, you can't do that by sitting at your desk. It doesn't work.
Just thinking about it. Visiting Cuba sounds great. we have an intrinsic empathy problem in that by working on a tool that you end up using every day to do your work means that you're immediately not going to be able to empathize with the way that every single other user who uses your tool is going to use it, which I think, you know, one of the reasons we have a research team and a data science team in such a small company is that we have to keep connected constantly with like the realities of how other people are using our tool and frankly how other people like run their companies. I think we idealistically feel like Asana wants to, you know, be a better company. We talk a lot about company process and a lot about culture as sort of like our second product. And in doing that, it's a bit of a double-edged sword because it means that we will potentially build things that are idealistic and from our lens, and then, you know, when someone who works in a company where their boss just kind of expects them to get these five things done, we can fall down pretty flat. So for us, and as a designer, you're constantly dealing with feedback that is coming from this place of, you know, personal 40, 50 hours of, you know, a week of use of this product, and you both have to be a steward of, like, understanding what their problems are, but also making sure that you understand, you know, how other companies work, how, you know, what the actual tensions are here. And for us, it's a big part of a big part of that is starting from, you know, base level user problems and making sure that we have research where we're like, we don't do anything without talking to a customer and understanding like what their actual problem is and not necessarily, you know, the problems that we have internally.
Yeah, I mean, at Pinterest is the same thing. Research is incredibly important. You get amazing stories that you would never even thought of. What I've actually found in my experience is that the smaller the company, the less research you have. Typically, especially at like a small startup, research is under-indexed more so than design. We had a community manager doing her research for like a year who had no experience. She moved into a research role and killed it. She wasn't a researcher to begin with, and we really had to scrounge for those resources. And so, as a designer, it's also your responsibility to advocate for getting that research, and that comes back to getting people to trust you, right? And so, like, you just need to show them that this is important, and just bring a few users in, have them start talking to your team, or convince your team to spend half a day going to people's houses or workplaces, wherever they're using your product, and you get it. Like, as soon as you're there, you start to see it. So I've actually found it's the opposite of what you would actually think. At larger companies, I think they understand the value of research and how much empathy it does build, and so you really have a lot more resources.
So before the product even exists, how do you and your team design for an MVP and then assess response based on that and change the product accordingly?
Say research again. Research again.
Firstly, I hate the term MVP, but because it means so many different things, and sometimes it causes a lot of bad behavior in product teams, because they think that just slap something together and send it out there and see how it does. Well, yes, that's the general spirit of it, is you want to get something small out there quickly, learn from it, and get it back. But I don't think people really think carefully about what makes up a good MVP. And I think we need to spend a lot more time. One of the things I find is, if you're not careful, you're like, okay, these 10 features are gonna make it in, and boom, send it out there, see how it does. But really, we need to be more disciplined, be more scenario-driven. What are the two or three or four scenarios you wanna get out there? And I mentioned this in our roundtable, so I apologize for repeating myself, but if you don't think of it in scenarios, then sometimes people will say, it's 11th hour, we got to get the product out, we need to cut a feature. They rip out a feature, not realizing it cuts through a really important scenario. It could be some task completion transaction, e-commerce, or whatever it is. So you have to be really, really careful about how you plan for the MVP. I think it's invaluable that you have an MVP, but be careful how you think about it. And that's why I hate the term, because some people just, they don't really think deeply about it. They just think about it. Put anything out there, see what sticks, learn from that. So, that's
me. Yeah, that resonates a lot with me. I feel like people focus more on the minimum and less on the viable. And I think as a designer, I feel like you can have a unique sort of, the way we talk about it a lot at work is this idea of sort of like a narrative loop. So when you think of a use case, there's sort of a loop of activities that I have to be able to accomplish. I'm gonna have to be able to create a thing, know that something got edited and I probably need to be able to destroy it. And it's important to sort of think about, and that's obviously will change feature to feature, but it's important to think about, you know, what as a designer is this core loop and how many of those you have in a product. So then you get into these conversations where, you know, we have to make a trade-off and something's gonna go that you're centering around sort of a shared vernacular around like, well, we could like cut that out, but that like basically guts this loop and we kind of should take the entire thing out versus just sort of parting it out. And I think when you deal with MVP, it starts getting into very specific conversations about tech and, you know, cost and all these things to make these deadlines. And as a designer, like, you know, sometimes it is almost worth cutting even more if you're going to compromise, like, even a piece of one of these sort of loops that you encounter in designing features.
Yeah, at Pinterest, we kind of have a design process of designing good enough, good, better, and best. And I think a lot of times teams head straight for the MVP, but like the good enough version, without a vision of what's the best version that you can make of this. And so it's something we strive to do, is as long as it's not hugely wasteful and extremely risky, we will design what's the best version of this that we could possibly make. And from that, we utilize research, we put people in front of this product, and we start to just listen. What's really resonating with them? It's all anchored in those use cases and in the core problems. And we have goals in our mind when we're designing this of if we solve this problem, if we, you know, solve this use case, what's going to be the outcome of that, both like qualitatively and quantitatively. And so by putting it in front of users, the best version, we can start to pick apart, okay, what pieces are they really drawn to, and prove out, at least qualitatively, that this is potentially the right solution. And so from there, that's really how we develop our MVP, the good enough version, is by listening and start to really scope down what we're building. Equally important, I think, is collaborating with engineering to make sure that you're not designing something that, like, that little button's actually going to take 2 weeks longer than this other little button. Like, it seems really obvious, but I think it's something that all designers struggle with.
I'll just add one. All this is great. I'll just add one quick thought is that I hate MVP as well. I always think of it as more of like, where are we trying to actually go? What's our long-term vision of this, as you were mentioning? And what's the first step? That to me is the MVP. Like, what's the first step? Because MVPs don't build toward anything. They're just, it's like shotgun approach. It's like spray and pray, basically. And so, you know, I always try to think of like, what's the first step of this journey we're gonna go on if we do this correctly?
I have one final question before we'll open it up for questions from the attendees. And so this kind of is based on the whole framework of the conference that brings together students with more engineering backgrounds, visual arts backgrounds, entertainment, filmmaking backgrounds, and is bringing them together in one room. So it's kind of, we're trying to highlight what it might actually be like in a company where all of these people are trying to work together. And so, Lindsay, you already kind of mentioned this, but what leads to a successful designer-engineer relationship? People coming together with different skill sets and maybe different vocabularies, and how do you come together to make the most successful product?
Thank you, sir. So I kind of mentioned trust earlier, but to build upon that, I always like to think of design and engineering and whoever as like, you know, we're all trying to do the same thing, which is solve a problem. And we happen to be doing it from like a user-centric, you know, sort of perspective. But we all have like a set of tools that we bring to this problem, and we're trying to use those tools, designers, whether you're an engineer designer or, you know, a motion graphics artist or whatever you may be, that's your particular set of skills that you bring to solve that problem. But we all have to be working, you know, in concert together to be able to create like something that is, you know, beautifully done and so simple that at the end of the day, someone's like, oh yeah, duh, of course it's supposed to be like that. And in order to make that happen, you really have to be able to have like a lot of confidence and you know, ability to communicate well across your different, across the team. So again, it's like, it always, you know, I think as mentioned earlier, it's always come down to relationships. That's the number one thing.
Yeah, I think just treating engineers as co-owners, like they're owners of this project, the product, whatever you're building as well. It's if you're treating them like they're a co-owner and you are checking with them constantly, they're part of even design crit, you'll start to create that relationship. I think a lot of engineers don't even realize the solutions that they have in their mind, and having the diversity of thought is extremely important. I think some designers, like really early on, they come in, they're like, I'm a designer, and therefore I'm magical and have all the solutions. And they try to go away for weeks and come up with a solution and come back and say, voila, and that's not how real solutions work. You need to collaborate with your team and have that diversity of thinking, and you'll come up with an even better solution that you never thought possible. And so I think treating engineering with that respect, and with that in your mind, that you're creating this team that's going to come up with the most ideal solution together, will resonate with them, and they'll bring more ideas to the table, and it will just become more and more collaborative.
Yeah, I totally agree. Diversity of thinking is super important. It's funny because I don't think we can make a great product without engineers, and I don't think engineers can make a great product without designers, because of the way we think differently, but we actually do complement each other. We complete each other. Yeah, I'm glad I'm not the last one that's gonna. I'm not gonna close the conference with that. No, but the engineers, I mean, they're logical thinkers. You break down the problem and they work through it in very logical ways, and designers are bigger thinkers usually in the beginning. And they try and look at the overall ecosystem, I think Daniel said, at the 10,000 foot view, and then they bring it all together. And I think you need that diversity, then you need a couple of beers or coffee, whatever it is, to get in a room with them and work through it. I think they really appreciate the fact that, and this is another thing, that you take the time to understand their space so that you can better dialogue with them. That's important too. If you're not very technically savvy, then try and understand what they're doing, but from their perspective, take some classes, get to understand that.
And in that way, like, if you have a bunch of unicorns, in some way, things, you know, there is no divide there, because you all theoretically can speak the same language, or maybe you're the only person implementing something.
I think it's based on the size of the company, to be honest. You know, we all work at pretty sizable companies, so the way the process works for the ability to move quickly is that we have people who specialize in particular areas. If you work at a startup where you're the only designer and you're also the only front-end engineer, that's very possible at a lot of small startups, and so you will be making everything that you design. It's honestly, I think that's something to like check in with yourself, like, what do you want to be doing? There's pluses and minuses both, but yeah, it's largely just dependent upon like the size of the company.
If you know a designer that's really good at coding, or a coder that's good at design, could you send me their resume, please? Because that is an invaluable skill to be able to do that. Not only the actual act of doing those two, but just the way they think would be very different. And actually, I think over time, I think we all try and do that. We're always, let's face it, if you've been in the industry for a while, you're pretty much self-taught. And that means we're always learning by reading or talking to people, and sometimes it's very technical people, and sometimes it's people that have a lot of design background. So we're always kind of learning and adapting, and therefore we get to push our teams even to get bigger and stronger. Unfortunately, there is actually sometimes designers that are really not familiar with the process of coding and how it gets in, and vice versa. So we actually have a discipline that's right in the middle of design and engineering. Right now we call them design integrators, and those are really front-end UI coders that have some good design sensibilities and can actually see when pixels are off. And so we actually, and they sit on the design team. And so as designs get done, we sit with them, and they're actually writing front-end code and getting our designs in, but they're sitting right next to us so we can actually iterate with them. And it's kind of unfortunate that we have to have that, but that's the reality of the situation, because these products are complex, really complex, that we're doing. So, and that really helps in getting our vision into product, you know.
Yeah, echo everything these guys just said. We do have what we call design prototypers on the product design team at Pinterest. I don't think we've cracked the process of when these prototypers are brought into projects. We do something called design workshops, though, which could be a week long where you have a problem to solve. You have a design prototyper, maybe two designers, and you're building something together and solving that problem. So that's extremely, it's extremely useful. But I think the biggest thing to echo is just how those people think is extremely important. They can speak engineering's language. They might not be able to implement it to the degree that the engineering team can, or be familiar with the process that the engineering team has. But the way they think, it bridges a gap that is extremely hard to bridge. So it's really valuable.
So you guys have talked a bit just now about like bridging engineering and design, and myself and these two also go to an engineering school that was established 20 years ago specifically to create engineers that have design skills and kind of can think like designers and then also have hard technical skills of an engineer. And y'all mentioned a couple ways that kind of those people can be integrated into your teams, but it feels like, I mean, those two specific examples were like, oh, they write code for visual things. And I'm wondering, moving forward kind of 10, 20, 30 years, how do you think engineers who do have the hard technical skills, but also are able to think like designers and have kind of original ideas beyond seeing if a pixel is off, can be fully integrated and productive members of that team?
I have a thought about sort of where design is going in the next 5, 10 years. And we're seeing this now at a lot of major companies, which is the ability to create components for design, like componentization of design, where basically designers are moving away from one-off designing things and just using built pieces, changing, and then using those pieces to create the solution. So the way I look at this is like right now we're just in the phase where designers are using this, engineers have their side of it, design has their side of it. We both have components. They are the same name, and instead of us providing like detailed red lines, we just say, here's the name of this component, and engineers know what that is, and they plug it in. But where I can see this going in the future is, it becomes so simple that like the designers are just doing that themselves. They're no longer passing that on engineers. It's, they said, here's the components we want to use, and they're actually like implementing that themselves, because it's just gonna get simpler and simpler and simpler to allow people of all types to be able to like do this. And then, I think engineers will then be focused on problems that are like much more intensive to like infrastructure or other issues that a designer is not skilled in. So I think we're moving in that direction, and I would never say like don't learn about programming, because I think it's going to be like highly valuable. I just think we're just sort of like on the cusp of that right now.
I think it's really cool that your school focuses on that. That's something I've never heard of before. I think eventually we'll get to this point where the gap is a lot smaller. But right now, I think it really depends on the team you go onto. If you went onto a team as an engineer and show them, hey, I have some design chops, hopefully they're able to utilize it. Like if any of my engineers came up to me and were like, hey, what if we came up with this? And like showed me wireframes or thinking, like utilize that thought, because that's really the complex thought that goes into it is what makes you a designer. I mean, engineers have that in a different way, PMs have that in a different way, but I think it really just depends on your team. So if you're interviewing in a company, really asking how they would utilize that skill would be something I would look for, like actually ask that question to see if they would just make you only be coding or allow you to also be integrated in different things. Maybe it's not like a dedicated designer developer role, but you're an engineer and you also get to be part of these workshops where you think through these difficult problems. So I think it's kind of a case-to-case basis too.
Yeah, we kind of hope with, as we build, I feel like componentization and sort of this like linking between product designers thinking about their work as a larger system and that being represented in code, as that becomes more prevalent, I think aspirationally my hope would be is that the divide would just become less because you're speaking more and more the same language, and that as an engineer, it's less about the specific cost of implementing this one thing, and we can actually talk more about, like, well, is this the right component? Like, why do you think this is the right component? And actually have, like, a richer conversation about the problems we're trying to solve, rather than, like, the nuanced details of everything we're trying to fix. So, in that, I would hope that, like, hopefully this divide gets smaller, and then in general, like, if you're learning both about design skills and about technical skills, then, you know, you're one of those ideal candidates that can help build those systems and be, you know, a conversational bridge between people who tend to skew a little bit to either side. On our team, we have one product engineer that sits on design, and their mandate is a lot about maintaining the system. And they're not only a steward for engineers inside of design, but they're also a steward for design inside of engineering. So they become like a conversational bridge where they, if there's like a translation difference, they can sort of find that difference and help facilitate it, which has been ridiculously helpful for us.
One thing that's interesting is you said something about the next 5 years, and it's already happening, but the big term AI, artificial intelligence, is rearing its head and means a lot of things to a lot of different people. And I would say that the ones that are hitting it the first are the engineers, and they're creative thinkers about it. We as design are still struggling to understand how does it really fit into the experiences that we build every day. And so I look at it as, I'm actually leaning a lot on the engineering teams to understand what does it really mean to have artificial intelligence in your system? What does it really mean? I mean, I look at it as, oh yeah, you can personalize the system a little more with users. But it goes deeper than that, and it's partially because of all the technologies and the models that they've built. And so this is a really great time to think about, there's so much potential, and there's really no divide. It's just like the ideas and technologies that come from everywhere, and how do we as a cross-discipline group of people come together to create great experiences for users. And I would just say that probably sums up most of what we're trying to do as designers and product designers.
Thank you so much, Lindsay, Jason, Cyrus, and Tyson, for joining us today.